ionizing radiation in tissues occur at an atomic level. So we're talking about the electrons here, okay? Two of the effects that we will be discussing is a direct effect and an indirect effect. Again, we're talking about the atomic level. At the molecular level, this is where these defects start to appear, okay? A radiation of macromolecules includes proteins, which includes enzymes, hormones, and antibodies. And then we'll talk about radiolysis, which is the indirect effect, and then damage to the DNA. And this is the one that's going to be more damaging. The ultimate damage is damage to the DNA. Everything else we can recover from, but when there's damage to DNA, the chances of any type of recovery from that decreases. So scientists and researchers have done different types of experiments of these macromolecules outside of the body. They've taken these different types of molecules, macromolecules, and put them in a solution and observe what would happen if these molecules were irradiated. This is what's known as in vitro, okay? So in vitro is irradiation outside the body or outside of the cell. So they're taking these molecules and putting it in a solution and studying the response to radiation. Now, it says here you need more radiation to produce an effect, which is true because you need more to penetrate the solution and get into the cellular body before it strikes the DNA. Now, in vivo, this is irradiation within the living cell, so this is direct radiation into the cell. It's gonna be more, more radiosensitive, and it's gonna be a lot more effective. Okay, any questions so far? So in vitro is outside, in vivo is inside. So irradiation of macromolecules in vitro within the solution, three things can occur. You can have main chain scission, cross-linking, and this is where we were talking about earlier with point lesions when there's an actual damage to the DNA. So main chain scission then is a breakage of the backbone of the long chain macromolecule. This essentially is a reduction of a long single chain macromolecules, and it's broken down into smaller molecules or smaller macromolecules. Now remember the solution in which these macromolecules are in. They can study the damage of these molecules by simply studying the viscosity of the solution. Generally in a main chain scission, if there is evidence of that, there is also going to be a reduction or a decrease in viscosity. And we know what viscosity is, right? It's gonna be the overall thickness, okay, of a particular solution. So something that's very viscous would be something like oil or like syrup, okay? And something that's not as viscous would be something like water, okay? So what we're talking about here is if there is main scission damage, there is decreased viscosity, okay? With anything else, if we are able to stop the damage prior to it replicating, it can these type of cells can fix themselves, okay, through intracellular repair and also recovery. The next one here is cross-linking. Now, in a natural state, these molecules have extensions coming from the body. They have a sticky extension to it, okay? So they extend out of the main chain. Now, again, this is normal. However, with radiation, we can actually produce these spur-like extensions. Okay? And so if you have these sticky extensions, these macromolecules can stick onto other molecules or they can stick on upon themselves. Now, how does it represent itself in a solution? Well, there's gonna be increased viscosity. Okay? Also repairable and recovery is possible through intracellular repair. Any questions so far? The last one here is point lesions. Now, point lesion is actual damage to the DNA. We're talking about damage to the base of the DNA. So this is a disruption of a single chemical bond in which the sequence of the bases are changed and altered. So when you're doing that, when you're changing it or you're altering it, now you've also changed the coding and the information. So several things can happen. You can either have cellular malfunction, okay? You can have cellular death, or the function just ceases altogether. This generally happens with low radiation doses. Is that something we should be concerned about?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So it can be undetectable and cause minor modification to the molecule. These type of effects we don't see until later on. They're stochastic. Low radiation doses demonstrate a stochastic effect. This includes leukemia, cancer, or tissue damage. Now, as we will discuss later on, these type of effects are random. It's not selective, it's random. And also depends on the type of dose and type of radiation that we're using. Okay? Any questions? All right, so to understand how radiation can cause damage, we need to understand synthesis on a molecular standpoint, okay? And then we'll also be more specific in discussing proteins and DNA and how they synthesize. So when we're talking about molecular synthesis, we're talking, the first term here is catabolism, and I think I introduced that to you last week, mm-hmm. Okay? Catabolism is, well, first of all, the molecular nutrients are brought into the cell through diffusion, okay? And also osmosis. Macromolecules are then broken down into smaller molecules, which then releases energy. There's a cycle going on here. So there's a breakdown, there's a production or synthesis. So when things break down, energy is released. Then that energy is used to synthesize more proteins. It's a cycle, okay? So when you're producing macromolecules from smaller molecules, it's called anabolism. Anabolism, not animalism. Mm-hmm. That's not laughing. Okay, thank you. Okay. Synthesis of proteins and nucleic acids is vital to the survival and reproduction of the cell. We need both proteins and nucleic acids to survive. Okay, so here's a rundown on protein synthesis. This is directly out of your book, okay? Proteins are manufactured by translation of the genetic code. So first we start off with the DNA, and we need tRNA to translate that genetic code. The code is then transferred by messenger RNA, and then finally that information is carried out by mRNA, and is transcribed into a newly synthesized protein.
We don't have that slide.
It's directly from your book. Yeah, so find out, I don't know what page that's in. So you guys need, oh yeah, take pictures. Take pictures, write it down. Does anybody know what page that's in the book?
Well.
Page what?
No.
Oh no? Nobody has a book?
49?
Old one. Okay, do you have the old one? You have the old one? Okay, 489. Page 489. Okay. So again, this is just a summary of what we just covered on the previous page. So radiation damage to macromolecules may result in cell death or, again, late stochastic effects. Proteins continuously synthesize throughout the cell. Now, that's a good thing. It's a great thing. Because when you have an abundance of a certain type of macromolecule and there's radiation damage, you have more to reproduce. So when we're talking about proteins, okay, whether it be enzymes, hormones, or the different types of proteins, if you kill one or two, there are more to replace it. Okay, so they are less prone to the effects of radiation than nucleic acids. Therefore, recovery and repair is more possible. Does that make sense? So again, this is just a brief review. We talked about this last week. This is just an extra slide. We talked about two theories of thoughts in the proliferation of cells. Okay, we covered this one last week. We said geneticists identified two phases. Mitosis, which is broken up into prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. Then you have interphase in between. But to better understand DNA synthesis, we need to look at it from the cell biologist's point of view. Okay? They recognize four phases, which is essentially the same as this, except they call it, it's a different name, different title, but it's the same thing that's going on over here. Okay, so these four phases are metaphase. Then you have G1, which is pre-DNA synthesis. Now we're talking about here, prophase and metaphase. All right, and then here, where DNA synthesizes, okay, what is this? This is gonna be anaphase, okay, to telophase, and this is gonna be telophase to interphase here at G2. Okay, same thing, just different names, different titles. Okay? So when they talk about DNA synthesis, they apply this model, not this model. They apply this model. Any questions? Okay. Yeah, no questions, so we can get out of here quickly, right? All right. So this is DNA synthesis. We talked about G1, S, and G2. G1 of interphase is the molecular DNA is in that familiar double helix form. Growth and replication of organelles start to occur. In the S phase, synthesis of the DNA occurs with the latter splitting up, becoming a single chain with no base pairing. So this is what's happening over here, where they start to split up without any base pairing. And interphase, now they start to reassemble, and assemble of the spindles come together. They form again a single chain. Base pairing occurs, resulting in two duplicate daughters having the same DNA. Again, this is metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. Same thing. But again, when we're talking about DNA synthesis, this is the model that they use. Okay, so as we said, DNA is gonna be the most important molecule in the body because it carries the genetic information for each cell. Each cell has a nucleus that contains DNA complex with other molecules called chromosomes. So basically all a chromosome is, and I put it down there, okay, all a chromosome is strands of information composed of DNA and proteins. We know that chromosomes control the growth and development of the cell, and it also determines the characteristic of the individual. You guys notice that this character is throughout the book? Mm-hmm. You know who that is?
The author?
Yeah, it's Bouchon. That's Bouchon. Miss Mitz actually met this guy. He's supposedly a real character. I mean, like a funny character. An odd character. Okay. Radiation effects on DNA. If radiation damage to the DNA is severe enough, physical chromosome aberrations or cytogenic damage may be detected. This can be both at a cellular level as well as a whole body level. So a few things can happen here. Here we have a normal chromosome. Here we have terminal deletion. So now we've eliminated one of the bases. Again, we're changing the whole code by terminal deletion. And then here we have C, dicentric formation. And I left a little note here for you guys. A dicentric formation is joining of two chromosome segments with two centromeres. Two segments with two centromeres. Now we've got extra information. And then the last one here is the ring formation of a chromosome, and that's where the ends of the chromosomes attach at the ends. They join at the ends. This can be radiation induced. Of course we know this is genetic, but this can also be radiation induced. And when you have radiation induced mutations, this is what will lead to things like microcephaly, spina bifida, what's the other one? Lifespan shortening, microcephaly, dwarfism. Those are some examples.
And that's for ring formation?
It's for any of these.
For any of them.
Yeah, any of these. Yeah. Oh, and I said learning disabilities, didn't I? Also learning disabilities. Any questions? No? Okay, let's keep on going. DNA damage without detectable aberration may lead to cell death. So again, if it goes undetected, it can cause cell death. If a sufficient amount of the same cells, that's the key, if the same cells, sufficient amount of the same cells respond similarly, the tissue, okay, it's going to be a snowball effect. The tissue or organ may be destroyed. It happens at a cellular level, but it keeps replicating and replicating and replicating, and eventually the tissue and the organ itself may die. Okay? This may lead to also abnormal metabolic activity, where you have uncontrollable rapid proliferation. If DNA damage occurs in a germ cell, the effects may not be demonstrated until future generations. So we talked about that. What is that called?
Poop squeeze.
Okay. Remember the genetic effect? You guys know about this. All right. Radiation responsive DNA. You have main chain scission with only one side rail is severed. Okay, this is A. B is main chain scission where both side rails are severed. Then you have C, main chain scission with subsequent cross-linking. And D, rung breakage causing separation of the bases. And then we talked about point mutations, which is the change in or loss of the base. Okay. Again, most types are reversible. However, when the sequence of the bases are changed and altered, this represents a genetic mutation at a molecular level. This is not reversible, and this is called point mutations. Okay? So anytime it alters the base, whether you lose a base or gain a different base or flip the bases around or whatever, okay? Anytime there's changes of the base, it's called a point mutation. It can be minor or major, but again, it's not reversible. And then when that happens, as the cells divide and replicate, they're carrying that same broken information from daughter cell to daughter cell. And then, we're not going to see this right away. Maybe latent effect, and we won't see this until later on. Remember the stochastic effect? So we may not see this until later on. So malignant diseases and genetic damage occur at the molecular level is observed as a stochastic effect and conforms to the linear non-threshold dose response relationship. What does that mean? Linear non-threshold.
No matter how low it is.
No matter how small, there's going to be effect. And as it increases, so is the effect. Okay. Was there a question back there, Catherine?
No.
No? You're good? Okay. All right. Put your hand down, Catherine. Okay, radiolysis of water. We're going to be talking about the indirect effect. The indirect effect of radiation. As we said, Most common type of interaction is irradiation of water because our body is mostly composed of water. Now, when X-rays, radiation interacts with a water molecule, it can be disassociated into other molecular products. First one here, okay? Okay, first of all, water are two ion pairs. You've got H2O, and then E is the radiation, okay? So when it splits up, several things can happen. First is that they can rejoin back into a water molecule and nothing happens, okay? If it doesn't rejoin, the negative ion can attach itself to another water molecule, disassociate some more, resulting into two free radicals. You have a free radical H and free radical OH, which then can recombine into back to water molecules, okay? That's great. If we can rejoin them, nothing happens. But if they continue to be free radicals, okay, they can cause ionization in distant places. So free radicals are highly reactive, are unstable, and contains excess energy that may be transferred to other molecules. Just like X-rays, they can disrupt bonds. They are easily diffused through cells, so they can enter other cellular bodies to cause these disruptions. Ionization can happen at a localized area, but can cause ionization distal to that initial ionization. Now, this is where it becomes dangerous. If you have a free radical OH, this can join similar molecules to form hydrogen peroxide. When that happens, it's toxic to the cell. H can form hydroperoxyl, and when two of those join, hydrogen peroxide is formed, which is also toxic to the cell. So this is a bad thing, but it's also a good thing because this is what they utilize in trying to, in radiation therapy, to kill those cancer cells. Okay, you have radiation and you're also trying to use free radicals to cause disruptions or toxicity in the surrounding cell with these free radicals. Does that make sense? Okay.
Okay, so that is a good thing if you want to kill cancer, right?
Say that again?
It's a good thing.
It's a good thing, yeah, because when that happens, we don't have to use high levels of X-rays. Mm-hmm. This is we're getting this by introducing, remember that hypobaric oxygen chamber, introducing oxygen to an anaerobic area? When we introduce more oxygen, this is what we're getting. Okay, this is what we're getting as a result. Okay, so we can use lower levels of X-rays. Okay, so damage caused by irradiation in vitro is known as a direct effect. The effect is produced by ionization of the target molecule, such as the DNA. This is just a review. Indirect effect occurs when ionizing events at the distant non-critical molecules transfers their energy to a target molecule. The principal effects of radiation on humans is indirect. Okay? So again, the primary effect that we experience as humans is radiolysis. It's the indirect effect because we are mostly composed of water. So this is most likely to happen than what's known as the direct effect. Okay, interaction of radiation on the atoms. All right, let's go on to the next chapter. So as we said, cells with an overabundance of similar molecules will not succumb to a noticeable radiation injury. Because if you have a surplus of them, if you damage two or three, there are two or three more that will replace it. Okay? Ionizing radiation can cause greater damage to cells having a low surplus of similar cells. Okay? The target theory. The target molecule. In the target theory, the target molecule must be inactivated for the cell to die. talking about radiation interaction. Radiation has to interact with the target molecule for the cell to die. DNA is the key molecular target. DNA is the molecular target. Every time I see this, I see fried eggs. I'm getting hungry. All right. So interaction with a target molecule is random. Okay? Radiation is also random. It travels in a straight line, but it's not selective. It just travels the straight path. Okay? And it's just going to strike whatever it's in its path, but it's not selective. It's random. Okay? Sensitivity occurs because of its vital cell function and uniqueness. We're talking about DNA. A hit, an interaction between an X-ray and the target is called a hit. A hit is said to have occurred when radiation interacts with the target, and it can be either direct or through radiolysis indirect. It can happen both ways. The lethal effect of radiations are determined by observing cell survival, not death. So when we're doing cellular study and how it reacts with certain radiation levels, what we're observing here is not the number of cells that die, we're observing the number of cells that survive. Okay, I know it's kind of funky that way, but that's how they do it. We're going to be discussing two different models here. The first one is a single target, single hit model. And the second one is the multi-target single-hit model. Remember, the key target here is what? The DNA. So a single target refers to those simple organisms, such as enzymes, viruses, and simple cells, like bacteria. When we're talking about multi-targets, it's a more complex system like us, the humans. So to better discuss this, this is out of your book, you've got what's known as Poisson's Law of Random Distribution. Poisson's Law of Random Distribution. The example that they use here is you've got a landing strip. This landing strip is broken up into different blocks or different sections. Okay? And it's raining. This airplane really has nothing to do with it. Okay? But it's raining. All right? We're going to use a fixed number. The fixed number that we're going to use here is 100 block tiles and 100 raindrops. Okay, 100 raindrops. Now, because it's random, the raindrop, did I say teardrop?
No.
Oh, I said raindrop, okay. I'm thinking Valentine's Day again. I'm just kidding. Okay. So raindrops and tiles. A tile is considered wet when one of the raindrops strike it. Okay? And if it doesn't hit one of those tiles, it's considered dry. But also all you need is just one single raindrop on a tile to consider it a hit. You guys follow so far? Okay? So if we have 100 squares on 100 raindrops, it's random. It's random distribution. And what the law says is that if we have 100 raindrops on 100 squares, only 63% of the tiles are going to be wet. Why? Because it's random, which means that some drops will hit the same tile twice, maybe three times, maybe four times, okay? And miss hitting another tile. And that is the result of 63% wet and 37 of it dry, based on 100 raindrops. It's random. Now, if we were to increase the number of raindrops, now you need to compare this with radiation. If we are increasing radiation, okay, more tiles are going to be hit, and only 14 remain dry. This is the survival, okay? 37 dry, 14 dry, and it's less dry because now we've increased the amount of raindrops. And if we increase the raindrops more or increase our exposure more, you are hitting more tiles. And now the amount of survival is minimal. Is that making sense? Okay. based on Poisson's law, not all bacteria will be killed because some are hit twice or more. Bacteria hit the first time should have died, meaning that other interactions with that same bacteria was wasted. Okay? Remember the raindrop, it's random. Some of those drops will hit the same tile two or three times. But all you need was that one drop and that tile is considered wet. At a bacterial level, if it just hits the target molecule once, it's dead.